Hello, ladies and gentlemen, Nick here. Sorry for any noise you might hear outside. I've got the windows open. This is just a little encoder at the start of this video to say that this ranking will indeed be a two-part ranking. I initially filmed it as one, but it's in the raw footage pre-editing, it's about an hour and 10 minutes or so. So I've decided to split this video into two parts. Part one will cover places 14 to 8. Plus all the introductory stuff, etc. And part two will cover 7 to 1 and a few overall thoughts on the book series as a whole. So, so there's this little encoder is just to let you know about that. So this is part one of the video. So this video will be ranking numbers 14 to 8. And then don't forget to come back for part two to rank number 7 to 1 when it comes out. Okay, enjoy the video. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, Nick here, and welcome to my ranking of the James Bond books written by Ian Fleming. So we will be ranking the 14 books written by James Bond creator Ian Fleming. Those are the 12 novels and the two short story collections, which cover the 9 short stories which I mentioned in the short stories ranking. You can check out my thoughts on each of those in that ranking, as well as in the reviews of the two book collections that they're part of, and my thoughts on the novels in their respective reviews as well. So I've done reviews of each of the books, so you can check my thoughts on the novels and the short stories in those, as well as the short stories in the previous ranking. The James Bond Ian Fleming book ranking. In this ranking, as I mentioned, ranking the 14 books by Ian Fleming. These are the first 14 Bond books ever, as Ian Fleming created James Bond, obviously. And so, the books I will be ranking will be Casino Royale, Live and Let Die, Moonraker, Diamonds Are Forever, From Russia With Love, Dr. No, Goldfinger, For Your Eyes Only, Thunderball, The Spy Who Loved Me, On Her Majesty's Secret Service, You Only Live Twice, The Man with the Golden Gun, and Octopussy and The Living Daylights. I might also provide some thoughts on the books overall at the end, but let's get down to the ranking so I don't waste any more time. Starting with number 14. Right, I'll quickly say now that numbers 13 to 7 are all 8 out of 10s overall in the case of the short story collections, with the top 6 being 9s up to 3 and then 2 10s. But this bottom one, unfortunately, is a 7, which is at least not as bad as the films, where the lowest it went was a 4, and there's more 7s with the films. But in all honesty, this is a pretty sloggy story, this book. It's a pretty much a drag, and it's definitely the one where you think, well, Ian Fleming clearly isn't enjoying writing this one. Bond's not having a good time on his mission, so why should we care? Why should we have a good time if the writer and the character aren't having good times? If they're not interested in their story or in what they're doing, why should we be interested? And that's Diamonds Are Forever's biggest problem, and that's why it's number 14. Number 14 is Diamonds Are Forever.
Diamonds are forever. They are all I need to please me. They can stimulate and tease me. They won't leave in the night. I've no fear that they might desert me. Diamonds are forever.
Basically, for the reasons I just explained, if Bond is basically bored throughout in this novel, and I can clearly tell that Fleming is kind of a bit bored in this instalment, considering he was considering killing Bond after the next novel, after five books, this would have been a pretty weak penultimate story. Thank goodness we went up to 12 novels and two short story collections, and the series has continued since then under other writers and in the films and other adaptations. Thank goodness it wasn't just five novels, because this would have been a piss poor penultimate story for the franchise. This would have been awful. This would have been a bad penultimate entry. Thankfully, as it's not the penultimate story of the novels, it's able to not be as piss poor. It's just not very good. It's got some good moments in it. There's some fun, enjoyable stuff. And I did give it a 7 out of 10, so it's mostly good. It's better than two of the short stories I gave even lower rankings to, as well as some of the films, but it's just, yeah, it's just not that interesting. At least in each of the films and the other stories, Bond's a bit more interested in what he's doing. I mean, maybe it varies from story to story, but yeah, at least in this is the one he probably cares the least amount. He's on a diamond smuggling follow-up. He has nothing to do with the Russians. This is the only of the first seven novels, then, to not feature the Russians as the villains, the KGB or otherwise. KGB Smersh or otherwise. But that's fine. It's good to have a bit of a break from having Russian agents, and it was clearly a good move on Fleming to move to non-Russian or non-working with the Russian villains in later stories, especially with the introduction of Spectre as a criminal organization. That was great. That was a great move on the writers of Thunderball. More on that later. But yeah, Diamonds Are Forever, whilst it's nice to have a bit of a break from the Russians as the villains, just like how Indiana Jones, it was good to have a break from Nazis as the villain with the second film. But like with the second Indiana Jones film, Temple of Doom, whilst it's nice to have a break from Nazis in those films, Russians in these books, the story just isn't as interesting or as engaging as the other stories in the franchise or the series, and it just isn't that compelling. Add alongside a Bond who just doesn't really care about what he's doing in this book. For the most part, he's just bored, senseless. And I feel like Fleming was also quite bored writing this one, which is a massive shame. Thankfully, he gets his mojo back for the next book, but more on that later. Next up on the list, however, is another early entry into the series. Number 13 is the second James Bond novel, Live and Let Die.
Say, live and let die.
Considered going back and rescoring this a 7 out of 10. It's a bit more of a slower Bond story, but it has some good moments in there. Bond's at least a bit more interested in this mission, for starters. I will say Solitaire is a more bland character. That's something I forgot to mention about Diamonds Are Forever, actually. That had a really great Bond girl, Bond woman, Tiffany Case. She's probably one of the best ones of the books. Solitaire, on the other hand, is one of the worst. Not only is she a damsel in distress, like how she turns up in the towards the end of the film, but she's quite a pretty boring character, honestly. I mean, she has a pretty good backstory, but after that, it's she's not really that interesting, and she doesn't really turn up that much after she joins Bond on the train. But then when she gets kidnapped again, she just disappears for a while. Honestly, I prefer being betrayed by Vesper than just hanging out with this version of Solitaire. Mr. Big is a pretty interesting villain, and he has a really great and gruesome death when he's being eaten by Barracuda at the very end. This book is definitely one of the more, I think it's a bit more racist, due to being written by Ian Fleming, who was a bit of a sexist, racist dinosaur. He's probably also transphobic and anti-LGBT as well. Basically, your typical British, white, middle-aged dude at the time, and probably wouldn't fit in today's society. So people who are anti-racism, be wary of this novel. In fact, the way Fleming writes black people in this novel is it's just as bad as how he writes gangsters in his novel, which is, let's say no more. There is some pretty interesting stuff to this plot, as it is kind of a bit of a treasure hunt, as Bond's trying to stop Mr. Big from finding Pirate Morgan's treasure. I believe it's Pirate Morgan. Or is it Captain Avery? It's a pirate's treasure off the coast of Jamaica. But yeah, Live and Let Die, it's a good story, but it does have a few issues. Ignoring some of the stuff that doesn't work in present day context and society that would not fly today. But besides that, there's some good stuff to it, but it's not entirely perfect. And like I said, Solitaire's a bit more of a bland character in this version. She's probably the weakest or one of the weaker Fleming-written James Bond women. It's also quite slow in earlier on. And also, Bond wants to go after Smirsch in revenge of what happened at the end of Casino Royale. But after thinking about, oh, this is my opportunity, this is my chance to do so earlier on, it doesn't really come to that. He doesn't really go after Smirsch and stop Mr. Big in revenge for Vesper or anything. I don't even think Vesper gets mentioned until, I would say, maybe from Russia Love, if not Goldfinger. It's from Russia Love or Goldfinger she's next mentioned. So there isn't really much acknowledgement to the past besides, oh, I can get my revenge of Spectre. And I think maybe having Bond more motivated to go after Smirsch could have been a bit more included in this story, and then afterwards it doesn't have to be as much in other novels, but for this one I think after Casino Royale there could have been a bit more Bond wanting to get after Smirsch and trying to damage their operations as much as he can attitude. Overall, Live and Let Die is a good novel, but I think there could have been some improvements, and I'd actually think the other novels of this series and the short story collections overall are stronger. Speaking of short story collections overall, number 12, the weaker of the two short story collections, if I could just grab the book. Oh yeah, preferences between books and films. I prefer the Diamonds Are Forever film to the novel, although they have the same score, but I prefer the film because it's more enjoyable and I at least enjoy watching Bond on his mission. Even if Sean Connery looks a bit more bored in that one, he's at least having some fun in some other places, and Bond himself isn't bored on his mission in the story, as opposed to the novel. As for Live and Let Die, the film is a 10 out of 10, and it's in my top 6 films at the moment. I'll do a film ranking after No Time to Die comes out. But basically, Diamonds Are Forever, has the same score as the novel, but I prefer the film because it's more fun and enjoyable. And Live and Let Die, the film's a 10, and the novel's an 8. So, yeah, you can see my preferences for those two. Okay, number 12, Octopussy and the Living Daylights. We're an all-time high. It's because I spent a bit of time on the other two. But yeah, this is the weaker collection of the short stories. I've actually forgot to mention that at the end of the ranking of the short story collection that Few Eyes Only had the stronger lot of stories. But some good short... There's three short stories in here that I like. Living Daylights, which is a 9. Octopussy and The Property of a Lady of both 8. And Living Daylights is amazing. Octopussy is really fun, and it's the best of the stories that focuses on another character besides Bond, and it does that really well. And The Property of a Lady is pretty good. It's not amazing. It's nice. It's all right. And then you have 007 in New York, which is one of the worst, if not the worst, written James Bond story. I go into more details on each one of these stories in the short story rankings and in the respective books' reviews. Same with Few Eyes Only's short stories. But 007 New York feels like it's starting a story, but it never finishes it. It's just a Bond's going off to warn this fellow agent of that her boyfriend's a KGB agent, but we don't see him do that. He's just fucking around New York for a bit. And then Fleming goes into a rant about how New York isn't the perfect city everybody thinks it is, etc., etc. Save that for Thrilling Cities, man. That's your non-fiction work. You can rant about the cities you don't like in that, but for James Bond, have a bloody story for it. This is just 8 pages of fluff, which is a massive shame because it's the latest published short story. It was probably one of the ones people were wondering, oh, what could this one be about? We haven't had it since it was published in newspaper magazine, whenever it was published individually. I wonder what it's like how I'm wondering what the other 5 short stories are like, the 3 that haven't been included on novels yet. I'm wondering how those ones are like. One of those could easily be worse than 007 New York. It could be easy as bland. But if they're anything like the two that we included on the Anthony Horowitz novel so far, those two are definitely better. But yeah, this one's just nothing. It's an absolute nothing. Property of the Lady is thankfully has a bit more stuff going on. Octopussy is really good, and of course Living Daylights is fantastic. If you see my short story ranking, this won't be a spoiler. Same for if you saw the book review, but if you haven't seen either of those videos, this is going to be a spoiler. Living Daylights is the best short story of the 9 released in Fleming short stories. Even if I was including the 2 included on the Anthony Horowitz novels, this would still be the best one. Living Daylights would still be the best one. And 007 New York would still be the worst one. Oh, and as for film comparisons, Octopussy and the Property of the Lady contribute to the Octopussy film, though I would probably take the film above both, but the short story is a nice companion piece to the film, actually, as I explained in the ranking. The Octopussy film is an 8, but like I said, I would put it above the 2 short stories. Living Daylight film's a 10, but it brilliantly adapts the 9 out of 10 short story into the film, as I mentioned in the ranking. And then 007 New York doesn't get adapted into... well, the plot doesn't get adapted into the film, into any film, although the character Solange does turn up in Casino Royale. That's ironic. A character turns up into a story based on the first James Bond book, and that character featured in the last story of the last book. Moving on to number 11. This one might be a bit surprising to people, especially if you're a fan of the films. Goldfinger.
Goldfinger! He's the man with the Midas touch. A spider's touch. Such a cold finger beckons you to enter his web of sin.
Now, before you Goldfinger film fans start going into a tizzy or something, the film is much better. The film is an easy 10 out of 10. This is only an 8. So, yeah, don't get into a tizzy. I love the film. Not so much the book. I like the book. I think I don't hate any of these. Well, apart from maybe 007 in New York. But I don't dislike any of these James Bond stories written by Ian Fleming. Yeah, there's some outdated stuff in terms of society and beliefs, and I don't agree with what he says on some things, but in terms of the stories and the plots, about almost all of them are good. So, yeah, I like Goldfinger. So please don't get upset that this is only number 11. Especially since if you're a film fan who's getting upset that this is number 11. Like I said, I love the film. So, yeah. By the way, I don't know who these people are. I'm just saying, just in case there are any of them here. Right, so Goldfinger. Okay, so it's a good story. I think what gets translated into the film from the book is probably some of the best stuff. And what that's changed in the film is probably an improvement, such as Goldfinger's plan. He just wants to rob Fort Knox in the book, whilst in the film he wants to irradiate it so that his own gold can go up in price. And China, who are helping Goldfinger out in the film, as opposed to Russia in the book, get economic devastation in the West, so they get a boost in economy over there. So the film actually is able to change some of this stuff to make it even better, to be honest. I also, whilst I do like Tilly being in a bit more of the book than in the film, I think the way her death was handled in the book wasn't quite as good. So I mean, either keep her in for the entire story or get rid of her sooner than how she's in the book. Maybe not as soon as in the film, but Sooner than when she is in the book, maybe about halfway through. She turned up halfway through, I think. Well, halfway through her time with Bond, maybe there could have been an accident or something. I do like how this book is... some of these books are split into 2 or 3 parts, and I do think this is a really good way to split the story into those 3 parts. The first part sees Bond meeting him on holiday by a coincidence. He's helping out a guy who appeared in Casino Royale, and then he goes back to the UK, where M has a mission for him concerning Goldfinger. The second part sees him trying to meet up with Goldfinger and following him, and then eventually encountering him a third time. And then the final part sees the main bulk of Goldfinger's plan. It's nicely built up to in the story. as well. But I do think it is a very long and slow story in places. This is probably I think it's the longest of the Ian Fleming novels. It's definitely the biggest one. I think it's the longest and got the most number of pages. 372. It's nearly 400 pages. I think this is the longest one. So, there's quite a lot going for it, and there is quite a bit of a slow stuff, but it's still a pretty good story, works really well, and a good adventure. But like I said, I think the film does it a bit better, like, significantly better. We've got a lot of films that are better than books at the moment, but there will be some books that are better than the films later on, but not just yet. I think the first one will be my number 7 choice, actually, possibly. Moving on to number 10, a lot of you are probably going to be surprised that I put this one above Goldfinger, and maybe also Live and Let Die, and maybe even Diamonds Are Forever for some of you. But honestly, I think if this novel, and I do mention this in the short story ranking, I think if this novel wasn't part of the James Bond series, it'd probably be a bit more remembered and a bit more respected and liked. But as it's part of the James Bond series, it's a very different type of story to what we get in the other novels. And it's not very well regarded or remembered. The Spy Who Loved Me. I wasn't looking, but somehow you found me. I tried to hide from your love light, but like heaven above me, the spy who loved me is keeping all my secrets safe. Even writer Ian Fleming didn't like this story, and he doesn't feel bored whilst writing this one as much like he does in Diamonds Are Forever. At least he doesn't write Bond as bored as he was in that story. But he definitely, after this came out, he wasn't a fan of it, and he ultimately didn't want the filmmakers to adapt much of it into the films. In fact, just using the title, although the filmmakers did sneak in one of the characters and call them Jaws, and that's where the iconic character comes from. And yes, I do think the film's better, but I think this is an overlooked gem. It's not outstanding or anything, but I think it's an overlooked installment in the series. I think this is a very underrated story. I really enjoy actually reading this stuff about Vivian Mitchell, Michelle. It's actually some pretty good stuff in the first two parts of the book. Again, this is a book that's split into three parts. Goldfinger, it was the first two were 7 chapters each and then a 9 chapter one. And this one, it's a 6, a 3, and then another 6. And I actually kind of really enjoyed reading stuff about Vivian Mitchell and her life across the first, and how she ended up at this motel in the first 7 chapters, and then she gets herself involved in this dangerous situation in the 8th and 9th chapters, and then James Bond comes around at the very end of the 9th chapter, and we meet him at the start of the 10th, and he hangs around and protects Vivian, and the two of them fight up against these villains who have popped around, one of which, as I mentioned, inspires Jaws, and except in this book he does talk, whilst in the film he only speaks one line in Moonraker. But yeah, I think this is a pretty good novel. I do think the final third, when James Bond actually does turn up, is the weaker part of the book, which is probably the opposite of what many people think of this, but where they think it's not very good because Bond's not in it for 3/4 of the 2/3 of the book. But in my opinion, when Bond does turn up, that's when that is the weaker part of the story. Surprisingly, though, thank goodness I did try to imagine Roger Moore in this one, who is the Bond in the film, because I don't think any other Bond would work in this book besides Roger Moore. Apart from a few grumpy remarks, I think this book would definitely be tailored to a Roger Moore adventure, and I really can't imagine any other. I mean, other stories, I can imagine different Bonds to different stories. So I said I did Goldfinger with Sean Connery because he's in the film, but I could easily swap him out with Daniel Craig or Timothy Dalton. But with this one, I really can't see anybody besides Roger Moore in this one. And I think that helped a lot with enjoying that last third, because it does feel more like a Roger Moore adventure than, say, a Sean Connery one. Of course, Fleming wouldn't have known that when he wrote the book, of course. This didn't even come out before. This came out the year Dr. No came out, so they were only making the first film at the time. But yeah, I think this is a very underrated novel. I think you should give it another chance. I do think the Octopussy short story, which does something similar to this, does it a bit better, where it's focused on another character and Bond just is there for a little bit. But that's only for one 46-page short story, whilst this is 9 out of 15 chapters of a 15 chapter book. In fact, the whole story is told from first person point of view, and Bond's kind of left her at the end of chapter 14, and she wakes up and he's already gone in chapter 15. So, okay, the entire book then, the entire book is from another character's point of view, and this time in first person. And I do think Octopussy does handle it a bit better, where it's in third person, and it's a 46 page short story instead of a, well, in this publication, 212 page novel. In the vintage publications, 46 and 212 respectively. But regardless, I still think this is an underrated adventure. It's not as amazing as my top 10. It's only number 10 on this ranking, but I do think it's an underrated adventure. Check it out and give it another go. It's not your typical Bond, but that doesn't mean you have to dismiss it automatically. Moving on to number 9, back to regular Bond adventures now. Next up is You Only Live Twice.
And one for your dreams. You drift through the years, and life seems tame.
Okay, with You Only Live Twice, my experience with this one on the recent reread and my review, this is a two-parter as well, by the way. This is split into two parts. The first half I wasn't really that interested in. I was a bit bored by it. It was nice to see some parts of Japan and Bond in a bit of a retro on the events of the previous novel, but I wasn't entirely interested in what was going on in the later half of part one. It was getting a bit dull and slow and draggy. But then part two comes around, and well, I had a very long break between the two. I had about a month's break between reading chapter 11 and chapter 12. Was it 11 and 12? Yeah. But when I got around to chapter 12 in the second half of the novel, it was a much better breath of fresh air. It was really good. It was so fun to read. So whatever I was feeling towards the end of the first half was gone by the time I was into the second half, because it was really fun and enjoyable, and had some really great stuff to it. The best stuff is towards the end, of course, when Bond goes to confront Blofeld and Irma Bunt at the castle. It's such a great climax, and it's a great adventure and a really rollicking ride. Like I said, the first half just didn't grab me that well, especially later on. But the second half is must-read classic Bond. Oh yeah, and despite Connery's performance, I prefer the film. I give that one a 9, whilst this is just an 8. And speaking of the number 8, we'll now move on to number 8. And this is the other short story collection on this ranking. It's the better of the two. For Your Eyes Only.
Better short stories in this one. Whilst we don't get a 9 out of 10 like Living Daylights, the weakest we go is 5 out of 10 with Hinderland Rarity, and then the rest are 8 out of 10s. That's enough to say that this is the better of the two short story collections. Granted, there is one more than Octopussy and the Living Daylights, but this one's got 5, and 4 of them are based on the original story outlines that were going to be television television, whilst the other one, For Your Eyes Only, is exclusive to this short story collection, and it's the only one to actually be exclusive to this short story collection. I'm not sure if the 5 unreleased ones did get some sort of release, like in magazines or something, but For Your Eyes Only currently is exclusive to the short story collections, whilst the other ones were in either television outlines or appeared in magazines and newspapers and stuff. Same with the Raymond Benson and Moneypenny Diary short stories. Well, I think the Moneypenny Diary ones, I'm not so sure about that one. But anyway, so the For Your Eyes Only collection, really good batch of collection, and you definitely get a lot of a good variety of stories in this one, more so than obviously in the Living Daylights, because you got your typical spy adventures like From a View to a Kill and Risiko. It kind of got a personal mission with For Your Eyes Only, and you've got some Bond on holiday adventures. Well, I say adventures, with Quantum of Solace and the Hinterland Rarity. With Quantum, again, there isn't really much Bond going for it, and this is a weaker version of what Octopussy and Spy Who Loved Me did, as it's just Bond listening to this story about this couple, etc., finding their Quantum of Solace or whatever. And as I mentioned in the ranking, I think the plot of the film is better, but Fleming is a more competent storyteller than Mark Forster, and because Quantum of Solace's execution isn't very good, I prefer the short story to the film. Ouch. Even though the plot of the film's better, but the film is weaker made. And then the rest of these short stories are really fun and engaging in their own little way. I mean, For Yours Only has its slow moments as well, but it's a pretty good adventure. Hinterland Rarity is not your typical Bond adventure, but it's fun. Risiko's good, really good, and For Your From A View To A Kill is also really good. And both Risiko and For Your Eyes Only are adapted into the film For Your Eyes Only really well, although I do prefer the film. From A View To A Kill, whilst it doesn't really have much adaptation to the film A View To A Kill, I prefer the short story over the film. Hinterland Rarity is translated into License To Kill. I think License To Kill is better. So there's a good selection of short stories in here. I think it's a better selection than in Octopus in the Living Daylights, where it's, I'm not sure if I could say it's varied. I just think each one's quite different with each other, but they're not quite as varied as maybe this adventure. Unless that's exactly what it means. Moving on to my 007 position of the ranking. Hello again, Nick here, providing a end coda to this video before we go to the credits and titles and stuff. Like at the start, this is just a reminder that this is a two-part video, and we have done numbers 14 to 8, and I will quickly recap them. Number 14 is Diamonds Are Forever, 13, Live and Let Die, 12, Octopussy and the Living Daylights, 11, Goldfinger, 10, The Spy Who Loved Me, 9, You Only Twice, and 8, For Your Eyes Only. Don't forget to come back to part 2 when that video comes out to see my ranking placements for numbers 7 to 1. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you guys next time. Goodbye. For your eyes only. Don't forget to click below to subscribe to the Nicholas Payne Retro YouTube channel.